strangely strange, but oddly normal.
Hi, I'm Charlotte Philipson. And welcome to another episode of On the Track.
I love this time of year. It seems that there's something new happening every day. Spring is beginning to imperceptibly turn into summer, and all sorts of summery things are going on. For example, here, Graham and Saskia are preparing the quail's summer quarters. They spent the winter in a converted rabbit run inside the conservatory, but now it's time for them to come out into the bottom aviary. There's quite a lot to do to be able to make the aviary habitable, and here Graham is fixing up, making do and mend, and Saskia is replenishing the straw and the hay and the nesting boxes. These are actually Japanese quail, a close relative of the common quail, which is a summer visitor to the United Kingdom. They're not very good flyers, but they can fly. But the most important thing is to give them a lot of cover and a lot of places that they can hide and do things on the ground, because they spend 99% of their time on the ground of the aviary. I've always been particularly fond of quail. And these four that we have, I think, are all females. Although one of the birds does try to mount the other three, it seems more like a show of domination than anything else. Unfortunately, common quail are not as easy to get hold of. I hadn't realised until Charlotte asked me as we were putting together this episode of On the Track quite what a wide distribution these birds have. As you can see, they breed right across Europe, up to the borders of Scotland and right across much of Russia. They are resident, that's the coloured green, in parts of southern Europe, bits of Africa and India. And they overwinter in India and quite a lot of the middle of Africa. Quite an extraordinary feat for such small birds. Maybe in the light of this I should reconsider what I said about them not being strong flyers. Japanese quail, however, are semi-domesticated species that have been kept in captivity for a long time. But like the common quail, their close relative, they too cannot spend the winter in the same place where they spend the summer, which is why these ones spend the winter in the rabbit hutch inside my old conservatory. But why am I saying old conservatory? Look at the amount of work that the girls have put in. It looks brilliant, doesn't it? Charlotte has pointed out it wasn't just the girls who did it.
It was also the boys.
Well, one at least.
The boy being Saskia's younger brother, Riley. But then again, I suppose you could always count Graham, Richard and even me, who've done little bits towards it as boys, I suppose. But there's been an awful lot of work done this month by the girls, particularly Saskia and Charlotte. I have been wanting to have a proper wildlife pond in the top of the garden for the last 8 years, and now it seems that we're finally getting there. Charlotte and Graham finally put in the waterfall that I have been plotting to buy for a long time, and I'm really rather pleased with it. If you don't look too closely, you'd never believe it was fiberglass.
So Charlotte, what are we doing?
We are... I'm doing the stones to make it look more natural, because so you don't see it's plastic, and Graham is... siphoning the pond, so then we can fill it up with better water.
I think it looks really good, don't you, honey?
Yep.
Archie seems to think so as well.
The whole process has been carried out over more than a year, and it's been quite a difficult and expensive one. Last year we showed you how the pond was installed, but now we're doing our best, or rather Charlotte and Graham are doing their best, to make it look natural. We have spent over £50. on these bags of biodegradable bark chippings, and when you figure out that they're only £3.50 a bag, that's one hell of a lot of bark chippings. Also last summer we invested enormous sums, well that's 75 quid I think, on a ultraviolet pond filter, which hopefully does keep the water cleaner and nicer than it would have been otherwise. Here you can see the water being pumped through the totally unaesthetic plastic tubes which we're trying to bury underneath rocks and bark chippings to make the whole place look a little bit more aesthetic. Even now, if you don't look too hard, it's easy to forget that the waterfall is actually made out of fiberglass. But I hope that when the plants that Charlotte's putting in and the other marginal plants that we get have embedded in and spent a summer here, that in about a year's time you really wouldn't know that it wasn't natural. The whole point is to have it as a wildlife garden and a resource for the local wildlife. Charlotte's latest discovery would imply that it's already fulfilling that role.
So this is a newt that I found while I was clearing off the rocks to do the waterfall. So I'm just about to let it go. I don't know if it's a girl or a boy. I think it's a rare species, Jonathan said. So I'm going to film it and film me letting it go. So here we go. Come on, little guy. He's quite the escaper as well, so. Ooh. Ah, over there might be a better place. Onto there. There you go.
It turned out that it was a female palmate newt, the smallest of the three species found in the United Kingdom. The identification was made by our old friend Lars Thomas in Denmark. I have to admit that I was a bit disappointed. Over the last few years we have received some evidence that there are also smooth newts in small numbers around this area, and I was very much hoping that it was going to turn out to be a female smooth newt. But I think it's probably too much to hope that one of these would turn up in our garden. However, the only specimen I have of one was found dead and mauled by a cat, presumably at the top of the road outside our window. So stranger things do happen. But newts have been quite a recurring motif this month. But you can't guess what this is, Graham. Unless I am very, very much mistaken, it is a clutch of eggs from a Spanish sharp-ribbed newt. And I have no idea how to unwrap them or anything. I have to say at the moment it doesn't look like eggs, it looks like some damp... Oh, there they are, you can see
you
the...
You need a lot of them if you're...
You can see the
bacon.
But look at the... You can see the embryos. Can you see them?
I can see dots.
Squiggly things, those are embryos. Okay, you're going to have to take these into the conservatory. There is a tank, little tank set up on the wall.
I am looking for the tadpoles, which are in this tank. Now, there's one just there. Sorry, I can't place my... Just there. See? Literally, like, just right under my finger. Those are the eggs. Just there. We think some of them may have hatched. We're not quite 100% sure yet. Probably about 50-50.
Well, Charlotte was quite right. There was only a 50-50% of the chance that the newt eggs were going to hatch. But in the event they did, 2 days later, Saskia went in to clean them out and found that 8 of them were hatched and several others were in the process of hatching. Here we have the definitive proof. Now, what are they? I have already explained why I don't know if these are sharp-ribbed newts or axolotls. However, they look very much like the tadpoles of palmate newts, a species which I have bred. And so I suspect that these, also because they're considerably bigger than the other ones, are probably the sharp-ribbed newts. But enough of newts. Let's go to ghostly devil dogs from the dark realms of Hades.
What are you on about?
One of my favourite Fortean freaky books is, and always has been, The Hound of the Baskervilles by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. And it so happens that my niece Jessica is studying this very book for her English GCSE. And it also so happens that because the current education system and her school in particular are just a bowl of worm gears, that I am tutoring her in the book for the aforementioned English GCSE. And it also so happens that the other Wednesday, while I was tutoring her in Hand of the Baskervilles for her English GCSE, who should turn up but Charlotte? Do you remember that, Charlotte? And it so happens that this week in the news there's been a story which is very apposite to studying my favourite Sherlock Holmes novel. But first of all, Charlotte, are you wondering why I'm playing this music?
No, not really.
It's a song called Hellhound on My Trail by a guy called Robert Johnson, who's popularly supposed to have sold his soul to the devil in order to learn how to play the guitar.
Ollie Murs never had to do that.
Well, I've only got the vaguest idea who Ollie Murs is and don't really care. But I am interested in the latest story about Black Shuck, the devil dog of eastern England.
The devil dog, black dog, heath hound, yet hound, or black shuck, depending on whereabouts in Britain you are, is one of the best known ancient British animal archetypes. In fact, it spreads much wider than this, and they have been reported all across northwestern Europe and further afield, even including places like Costa Rica. One of the best known is Black Shuck of East Anglia. Black Shuck was the subject of a terrible song by a not very good glam metal band a few years ago, and people are surprised to find out that it has been seen well within living memory. When I was a boy, for example, our family doctor in Bradworthy, about 5 miles away from where I still live in North Devon, had his elderly father, also a doctor, living with him. And his elderly father told me when I was about 13 how, when he had been in early middle age, he had heard a commotion outside his front door, gone open the door, and heard a ghostly pack of hounds running up, baying at the moon, running up and down the lane outside his house. He didn't see anything, but he heard them. And on another occasion, he opened the door, and he heard a single enormous hound rushing into the front door and up the stairs of the old house. There have also been sightings within the past 30 or 40 years in conjunction with the most famous, or rather infamous, black dog of all in the West Country, that associated with the tomb of Richard Capel, who was buried in a peculiar pagoda-like structure in the graveyard of the now deconsecrated church at Buckfastly in South Devon. But I digress, let's get back to Black Shuck, because this week, Black Shuck has been in the newspapers.
So, this thing's like a ghost. How does a ghost get into the newspapers?
That's a very good question, Charlotte. For years, people like me have thought that it was some kind of ghost. But now, for the first time, very recently, there has been what appears to be physical evidence of it, or at least of some sort of enormous dog, in the very area where these things have been seen, and very close to the scariest and most important of all the sightings.
If you believe the story, Black Shuck appeared during a storm on August the 4th, 1577, at Holy Trinity Church in Blytheborough, about 7 miles from Leyston in Suffolk. Villagers were reportedly sheltering inside the church when the huge clap of thunder caused the doors to burst open and the snarling dog crashed in. It ran through the congregation, killing a man and a boy before the steeple crashed through the roof. The dog then fled, leaving scorch marks from its claws on the church door, which are still visible today. Later the same day, Black Shuck is said to have struck again 12 miles away, killing two worshippers during a service at St. Mary's Church, Bungay, when the storm was still raging. Clergyman, the Reverend Abraham Fleming, is believed to have described the appearance of the legendary hellhound in a pamphlet written in 1577, entitled A Strange and Terrible Wonder. He wrote, "This black dog, or the devil in such a likeness," going on to suggest that it was the Lord only who would know which it was running down the body of the church with great swiftness and incredible haste amongst the people in visible form and shape, passed between two persons as they were kneeling upon their knees and occupied in prayers, it seemed, wrung the necks of them both at one instant clean backward in so much that even a moment where they kneeled, they strangely died. The legend has become incredibly popular, with images of the dog put up all across Bungay in letterboxes, weather vanes and such like. Within the past few weeks, archaeologists have described, unearthed and examined the bones of what appear to be an enormous 7-foot-long dog, found buried in a shallow grave in the grounds of Leyston Abbey, only a few miles away from both Bungay and Blytheborough. Interestingly, it appears to date from the same sort of period as the attacks took place in the two churches. Is it the animal responsible for them, or is it just simply a coincidence? Well, as an old and dear friend of ours once said, there ain't no such thing as a coincidence. Whether or not this is the most beautiful British butterfly is open to debate. It is not quite the rarest, but in most people's minds, especially mine, it is the most spectacular. It is the European swallowtail. Isn't it gorgeous, Charlotte?
Yes, it is very gorgeous.
Despite its name, the Eurasian swallowtail is not just found across Europe and Northern Asia, the Palearctic region, but it's also found across North America as well, making it a very widely distributed species. And it has at least 40 subspecies, one of which is only found in Britain. Now this is where the news which I've got to tell you is both exciting and somewhat worrying. First of all, Charlotte, you do know what a subspecies is, don't you?
It is like there's one main species and there's like, I think of like a tree, like there's one main tree and then like little branches. Like they're like different species coming off of it.
But ones that are not different enough to be new species.
Yeah. So they're in the same family, but they're not different enough to be their own species. They're just like a subspecies.
The British subspecies of swallowtail is a very specialised creature indeed. It only lives now in parts of the Norfolk Broads in East Anglia, and its caterpillars will only feed on a plant called milk parsley. The European subspecies, however, Gorgonus, rather than Britannicus, the British subspecies, is a far more hardy creature with a far larger range of food plants. We reported last year how at least one pair appeared to have bred in Dorset. Well, we can tell you now that it's much more exciting than that, because it appears that there have also been overwintered chrysalids which have been hatched out in the wild in Kent, Sussex and Hampshire. The early signs are looking encouraging for the European subspecies of the swallowtail to recolonise southern England. It used to live here 200 years ago and it looks quite possible that it will be coming back. But is this entirely a good thing?
I'm guessing it isn't, but why?
Because if the European swallowtail does successfully recolonise southern England, then eventually its range will increase to include East Anglia. And if it gets to East Anglia, then it will probably interbreed with the remnants of the British subspecies, which will mean that the British subspecies will become lost forever. Pretty much the same thing happened in the late 1970s. It was widely believed that the large blue butterfly was extinct in Britain, although people like me knew that there were populations in Heartland Point and just outside Bude. A few years later, there was a highly successful reintroduction program using butterflies from mainland Europe of a different subspecies to the ones that had once lived in England. Whatever remnants there were of the original British large blues were destroyed through genetic dilution. So one has to make the big moral decision here. Is it simply enough to have these beautiful butterflies flying across the English countryside once again? Or should we do our best somehow to preserve the remnants of the indigenous British race? Does it really matter that much? And if so, how on earth are we going to do it?
Hello, and these are my guinea pigs. This one here is called Brownie, short for salted caramel brownie. Then this one here is called toffee chocolate fudge, mainly because they're colours and they do act, and I think they're really cute, me, so, and I think that it really suits them really well too. At the moment they're being quite chatty, so this one is probably the most chattiest. Can you hear that? It's really sweet and really cute. It's so sweet, and I just really enjoy them seeing it. So, and this one, the little white bit, I've got a feeling is partial albino. Mainly because of this bit here, and this bit at the front. So, I've had them for... I got them on Thursday, so I've had them for a few days. And they're really sweet. I really enjoy having them.
I've always been very fond of guinea pigs. I like the noises they make. And believe it or not, there's even a cryptozoological guinea pig, or a cryptozoological creature that resembles a guinea pig. This is La Gomera, one of the Canary Islands. Although politically part of Europe and geographically located off the coast of Africa, they're actually not part of either continent. They're part of Macaronesia, the collection of islands and reefs across the middle of the Atlantic. If you believe in such things, they are said to be the remnants of the lost continent of Atlantis. Now, I don't really believe in Atlantis apart from as an Iron Age destruction myth. But in recent years, I have become very interested in the biology of some of these island groups, particularly the Isles of the Blessed, Madeira and surrounding. An old friend of mine, who has a Spanish family, told me that there were stories, and had been for a long time, that there is an endemic guinea pig-sized creature that lives here on the high wooded valleys on the side of the volcanic peaks of La Gomera. But if these things actually do exist, and if they are indeed related to guinea pigs, what are they? Because guinea pigs and their allies, like maras and pacas, are only found in South America. Well, it was suggested to me once that they could have been brought back from the New World to the Canary Islands by accident, or rather, brought back by design and liberated by accident. It's been suggested that in the same way as people in South America still kill and eat cavies of various types today, that the Spanish mariners who were coming back from the New World along a long, grueling ocean journey might have brought cavies of one or another species along with them as food. And then, if some of them are still alive and still uneaten before the end of the, at the end of the journey, liberated them for reasons of their own. It makes a bizarre sort of sense, doesn't it?
But enough of mystery guinea pigs. It's time to go over to my lovely wife Karina and our regular monthly visit to the Watcher of the Skies.
I have always felt a curious affinity with this species of bird, probably because for 30 years I was a secretary, and this is a secretary bird, a highly specialised ground-dwelling bird of prey from an older family than the other Old World raptors. It is native to sub-Saharan Africa and is sadly non-migratory, so will never be a natural visitor to these shores. But I think you'd be surprised quite how many completely unexpected avian visitors Britain does have, and that's what this segment of On the Track is all about. Bernard Heuvelmans himself said that cryptozoology wasn't the study of monsters, but the study of unexpected animals, and in the UK, what could be more unexpected than vultures, spoonbills and albatrosses? Yes, even the kings of the Southern Ocean have been seen in British waters. Two species of albatross have been recorded in the UK in recent years. Not all of our feathered visitors are quite so spectacular, but nearly every day there is something exciting to greet the Watcher of the Skies.
Britain's 10th crag marten was discovered in East Yorkshire at Flander Head mid-month. The last bird to be seen was in mid-April 1999 at Swithland Reservoir in Leicestershire. This bird breeds in southern Europe, North Africa and Central Asia, and winters south to North Africa, the Middle East and Southern Asia. Its natural habitat is rocky areas and towns, and it feeds in flight on small airborne invertebrates. Cornwall claims the first record in 1988. On the 11th of April, the Outer Hebrides' first serin was recorded in a garden at Askenish. This is a scarce breeder of passage visitors to the UK and has its world distribution in Europe and Northern Africa. It lives in open woodland and farmland and eats seeds with occasional invertebrates. It was first recorded here in Hampshire in 1852, and the first breeding record was in 1967 in Dorset. A collared pratin coal was seen on the open coastal plain of Devon's Northern Boroughs on the 21st of the month, which was the fifth for the county, as well as being the first for almost 60 years. It was in 1956 during May that one was last seen in Braunton. It breeds in southern Europe, North and Central Africa, Central Asia, and winters south, South Africa and India. It lives on sparse grassland and feeds mostly on insects, especially beetles and grasshoppers and locusts. The first record was in 1807 in Cumbria. The third record for Ireland came with the sighting of a male Sardinian warbler in Scott's garden on Dursey Island, Cork, although this bird is a regular but vagrant in Britain. The last seen in Ireland were males in April 1993 at Cape Clear and Knockadoon Head, both in County Cork. This warbler breeds in the Mediterranean and winters south to North Africa. It lives in dry scrub and feeds mostly on insects, with fruit in the autumn and winter, and it was first recorded in 1955 on Lundy. An alpine ascenter was spotted at home in Norfolk, which is the first British sighting for a decade. The last also an April record from Norfolk at Side Strand on the 20th of April back in 2004. It is a robin-sized bird of bare mountain areas and can be found throughout southern temperate Europe, Lebanon and Asia above 2,000 metres. It eats insects taken on the ground, some seeds in the autumn and winter. Britain's fifth Kretschmar's bunting appeared on Fair Isle on the 27th of April. It is a migratory species breeding from southeastern Europe, notably Greece, through Turkey to the Levant and wintering in East Africa, particularly Sudan. Apart from this bunting being the fifth British record, it is a third at Fair Isle, following birds in 1967 and 1979. Its food consists of insects when feeding young and seeds out of breeding season. The name of this bird comes from the German physician and scientist Philipp Jakob Kretschmar, who found the Senckenberg Natural History Museum. And that's it for this month. So now it's over to Jonathan for this month's regular look at new and rediscovered species. Bye bye.
Strangely strange, but oddly normal.
The alligator snapping turtle is the largest river turtle in North America, weighing in it up to 200 pounds and living for almost a century. Now researchers from Florida and the University of Vermont have discovered that it's not one species, but three. Examining museum specimens and wild turtles, the scientists uncovered deep evolutionary divisions in this ancient reptile. Once heavily hunted turtle meat, alligator snapper was the main ingredient of Campbell's turtle soup in the 1960s. The riverine populations have been deeply depleted and are of conservation concern. The new discovery indicates that these animals are more in peril than previously understood. The two new species both live in the southeastern United States. The Suwannee alligator snapping turtle is found in Florida and Georgia and lives only in the famed Suwannee River. It has been a distinct species for at least 5 million years, the scientists discovered. The Apacheliola alligator snapping turtle lives in Florida, Georgia and Alabama in and around the Apacheliola River and developed as an independent species a trifling 3 million years ago. The genetics work to identify the new lineages of turtle was completed by Joe Rome, a conservation biologist at the University of Vermont, and colleagues. The research was led by Travis Thomas, a Florida Fish and Wildlife Commission scientist, and is reported in the April 9th edition of the journal Zoo Taxa. A new species of louse-like crustacean has been discovered living on the bones of a dead whale at the bottom of the Southern Ocean around Antarctica. British researchers, using a remotely operated vehicle, ROV, to explore the deep sea floor, stumbled upon the bare bones of a minke whale. Speckling the bones were tiny animals that resembled woodlice, only smaller than what researchers discovered. The bones were completely covered in these little creatures. There were 500 to 6,000 specimens per square metre. Catherine Lintz, a researcher of the British Antarctic Survey who led the study, said in a statement. Genetic tests show these creatures, which measure about 0.15 inches long, represented a new species with close relatives living far away in the shallow waters of the North Sea near northwestern Europe. The new creature, a type of crustacean known as an isopod, has now been named Gyera thyleri. By extracting DNA from museum specimens, scientists have discovered three new species of yellow-shouldered bats. The fruit-eating bats belong to the Sternaria genus. They can grow to be 0.5 to 3 ounces, that's 14 to 85 grams in size, and live in tropical and montane forests from Mexico to northern Argentina. The creatures get their colloquial name from the male's shoulder glands or epaulets, which have a yellowish tint and give off a fragrant scent, said Bruce Patterson, curator of mammals at the Field Museum in Chicago. It's vaguely sweet and well-balanced, and invites a deeper sniff, Patterson told Live Science in an email. Having handled some 100-plus species of bat, I can say unequivocally that they're the best-smelling. Thank you for watching, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you enjoyed this episode. That's about it for this time. I'd like to apologise that this episode has been 3 weeks late. There's an awful lot of things happening at the moment, not the least that Karina and I become grandparents in September, and so we have an awful lot on our plate at the moment. But hopefully things will smooth out, and normal service will, like the BBC used to say, when there's something wrong, normal service will be resumed as soon as possible. I'd like to say a big thank you to Charlotte, and to Saskia, and to Graham, and to Dave, and to everybody else who's helped, particularly my lovely wife Karina, but for whom I wouldn't get out of bed in the mornings, and who is the only reason I do any of the things which I do. I love you very much, dear. Thank you for everything you do for me. We'll be back next month with all sorts of exciting news, including some stuff which I'm not able to talk about at the moment, but will very hopefully be resolved very soon. Hopefully, next month's episode isn't going to be anywhere as late as this one has been. So, until next month, be seeing you.
Strangely strange, but oddly normal.
La 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 la